Hello everyone, and welcome once again to another online gathering of WIN Singapore. Wherever you may be watching now, I am glad that you joined us today for another exciting sharing on God's Word. For those who are new and just joined today, I would hope that this would be a great start of your faith journey with us, and your experience here at WIN Singapore would encourage you to always find the time to continue joining us in this online platform as God ministers to your heart. And to our brethren who have been with us for a long time, thank you for your continued support all these times that we've been doing our online gathering. May we not grow weary in our online meeting together, and be encouraged all the more as we walk together in our faith journey with our Lord Jesus Christ. We are now halfway of our study series on the book Transformed by Pastor Rick Warren. And for the benefit of those who just joined us, we actually had our first campaign way back in 2015, and now we have again embarked on this and named it Transformed 2.0, where we have made some updates and made the series study more attuned and relevant to our times and experience. And the central and important truth that we all get to understand as we journey together in our study series is that God is in the business of transforming lives. In our study, God wants to transform our lives in seven key areas from the inside out. He wants to be involved and let us experience His plans and desire in our lives, in our spiritual, physical, mental, and emotional aspect, which we will be talking about further in a while. And as we progress in the series, we will discover the remaining key areas of our lives where God would also want to transform. What we came to realize and understand in our lesson so far in emotional health is that we are all bound to be hurt in one way or another. No one is exempted. This is a broken world inhabited by broken people, and thus we ourselves will be broken. We will get hurt, either by our own self-doing, by other people, or by circumstances we are currently facing or have experienced before. But the good news is that God is able and more than willing and ready to heal our hurts, our pains, or anything that is tragic or awful experience we've had. God intends to lift us up in our misery to enjoy His goodness and plans for us. If we surrender and lift our burdens to Him, then in His loving kindness and nature, as a good loving Father, will He give us the comfort and care we long for to get past over these lingering hurts. In our conversation today, we'll take a look at one particular character in the Bible, a woman whose life story is so relevant in our time that many of us can relate and probably emulate on how she dealt with the emotional mess she's dealing in her life. We will be talking about the story of Hannah in 1 Samuel chapters 1 and 2. So hold on to your seats as we unfold her story. I have titled our conversation today as A Heart's Desire, because Hannah's story tells us of her desire to be a mother and at the same time, her true desire to keep on trusting God and hold on to her faith despite of what she's going through. And here is the key takeaway that I want all of us can draw from our conversation today, and that is, God's loving kindness gives delight to a broken heart. Because the story of Hannah is one that shows the loving hands of God, weaving through history, to make things happen according to His design and timing. Firstly, what does loving kindness mean? The Hebrew word associated with this is chesed, or unmerited kindness brought about by love. In the context of God's nature and character, it means the steadfast love of God, and the object of that love is His people, us. God chose loving kindness not because we deserve to have it, but because it is His nature to do so faithfully forever. God's chesed gives delight to a broken heart. And because of God's love, He is able to heal our broken hearts and turn our grief and sorrows into joy and rejoicing. He calms our troubled spirit and gives comfort and peace to anguish and pain. I've made Hannah's story outline into four significant events, and they are Hannah's grief, encounter at the temple, God's purpose and timing, and Hannah's response to God. In Hannah's grief, we will get to know about Hannah and what's going on in her life and her sadness. We'll find out more why is she grieving and what or who caused her to grieve so much. At the encounter in the temple, we will know what Hannah did in God's temple and what did she do there and who did she meet. In God's purpose and timing, we'll touch on the topic of what was God's role in Hannah's life and what was God's plan for her. And Hannah's response to God, which is the last timeline, we will talk about Hannah's character and what happened to her at the end of our story. Now in Hannah's grief, our story revolves around a woman named Hannah. Hannah lived with her husband in Ramah, situated in Ephraim, which can be seen in the map right now, and is one of the 12 tribes of Israel. Ephraim is one of the two sons of Joseph, son of Jacob. And Joseph's other son is Manasseh, also one of the 12 tribes of Israel. Hannah was married to Elkanah, a man of high reputation and good social standing, given that the author of the book narrated his genealogy. And according to many Bible scholars, Hannah was the first wife of Elkanah, and Elkanah's second wife was Peninnah. And during that time, Elkanah and his family would always go for their annual pilgrimage worship and sacrifice to the Lord's temple in Shiloh. And the whole family would be on this journey, which would take days because Shiloh was on Ephraim's northeast side, while Ramah was on the southernmost part of Ephraim. And at that time, it would probably take them a few days of travel, perhaps 3 days including stopovers to reach Shiloh. They would usually stay in Shiloh for a few days before heading back home. And as we read in verse 5 of 1 Samuel chapter 1, "And though he loved Hannah," referring to Elkanah, "he would give her only one choice portion because the Lord had given her no children." We can read here that Elkanah loved Hannah so much. He adored her and actually truly cared for her. But unfortunately, Hannah was unable to get pregnant and give him children of his own. Now, interestingly, the words used to describe why Hannah can't have children were: her womb was closed or sealed by God, the Lord kept her from having children, or the Lord had not enabled her to have children. And usually, the term used in the Bible for women who can't be pregnant is barren. But as we can see, the writer did not explicitly use the word barren. Why? And this is significant because here, we are actually given a glimpse of God's plan. God was actually just delaying Hannah's ability to be pregnant so it will align in His purpose and His timing. There's a possibility that Hannah can conceive and have children. And later we will see why. But by now, we may already have an inkling of the main reason why Elkanah married a second wife, Peninnah, who was able to give him children unlike Hannah. And we believe that Peninnah gave Elkanah 10 children. And in those times, the husband of the childless woman would marry another wife to guarantee the continuity of his lineage. And reading through the narrative, we can sense that Elkanah loves Hannah more than Peninnah. And because of that, Peninnah was obviously jealous of Hannah because of the loving affection and care Elkanah showed to Hannah. On top of that, despite Hannah being unable to bear children, she has more authority and higher status as the first wife over Peninnah, who is the second wife. And in Peninnah's view, she should have higher standing than Hannah. She should be regarded as first wife and number one in the household and not just second to Hannah. Hannah is actually blocking her way to get the higher status of being first in Elkanah's household, because Peninnah believes she should have the position of first wife since she was the one who gave Elkanah sons and daughters while Hannah cannot even bear a child at all. But because Elkanah loves Hannah, she remains to have higher status than Peninnah as the first wife, which means she would have more authority in this household of Elkanah. And this makes Peninnah despise Hannah and tried everything she could to make her life miserable. We assume that for many years, perhaps more than a decade if we count, that Peninnah had 10 children, she bullied and mistreated Hannah and would make her feel worthless. Now we read in verses 6 and 7, so Penina would taunt Hannah and make fun of her because the Lord had kept her from having children. Year after year, it was the same. Penina would taunt Hannah as they went to the tabernacle. Each time, Hannah would be reduced to tears and would not even eat. Now, as we read, every year as they traveled to Shiloh to offer sacrifices and worship the Lord, Penina would make fun and taunt Hannah, probably calling her names and embarrassing her in front of their friends and other people. She was bullying Hannah to make her feel bad and worthless. Penina does all this terrible treatment to Hannah because of jealousy. But Elkanah obviously loved Hannah more than her. So to force Elkanah to switch their position and status, she tried to make Hannah look bad and worthless, and perhaps for Hannah to go away and leave so she can easily get the position of being the first wife. Imagine for more than a decade, year after year, Hannah was experiencing all these mocking and bullying at home, and every time they would do the pilgrimage to Shiloh. And so Hannah had to endure from Penina for so many years all these things. And Hannah couldn't bear anymore the bullying and shaming. She had enough of it and couldn't endure the mocking any further. Her chest was probably about to explode with anger and frustration and self-pity perhaps. Now let's pause for a while here. Similarly, with Hannah, how many of us have in one point in our lives got bullied? I know I am. Rejected, insulted, or hurled hurtful words that left deep wounds and scars on us that greatly affected the way we look at ourselves. That makes us feel inferior and have low self-esteem and worth. Well, that's exactly what Hannah was experiencing for years. The torment and torture, it was so excruciating for her. And women today can also relate to Hannah's plight. Those that have been waiting and praying to have children would understand Hannah's struggle, a feeling that their womanhood is incomplete, a loss of purpose by the idea that they can't experience bearing their own child or even experience motherhood. Now we go to Hannah's encounter at the temple and is the second important milestone in Hannah's timeline. When they had just finished their meal, Hannah went straight to the temple of the Lord, and here is where she broke down. And as we read in verse 10, Hannah was in deep anguish, crying bitterly as she prayed to the Lord. Now there at the temple of the Lord, Hannah cried her heart out to God, pouring the hurt and pain caused by Penina's continued insults and shaming on her inability to bear children. Her agony was so much she couldn't stand it anymore, and she needed to let out her frustration, so she poured it out to God, her deep desire and longing to be a mother. At that moment, she felt helpless and needed help. And Hannah just poured out before the Lord the depth of her heartache and the cause of her misery and deep hurt, the yearning to bear a child. In her moment of pain, Hannah chose to pray and unload her hurts to God. Hannah prayed from her heart, silently on the outside but crying inside. That's why Eli mistook her as drunk, because only her lips were moving but no sound was coming out. And during that time, the practice of saying prayers was that when they were recited, it can be heard when they are in the temple. Hannah turned to the Lord for help, the only one she knew who could change her situation. And as we read earlier, it was the Lord who actually sealed her womb, but Hannah didn't know it yet. Nevertheless, she went to God and laid out her problems, weeping and crying about her situation. She was desperate and knew deep in her heart that only God can help her. Like Hannah, when we are troubled, when we are distraught, when we are hurting, when there are so many lingering questions on our mind and we struggle for answer, choose to come to the Lord. Hannah asked God for help and comfort. She knew that only God can do something about her situation. Now, who do we approach first when we are hurting or discouraged? Do we run to God or do we run further away from Him? Hannah did not blame God for what she's going through, but instead chose to trust and put her hope in God Almighty. The God we put our hope and trust is an Almighty God. Do you agree? Nothing's too difficult for God that He can't do. His love for us endures forever. Like Hannah, in our crisis, in our circumstance, choose to lean on the Lord. Let our hope be anchored on His heart and not what we hear or what we feel. Just like Hannah, we can unload our frustrations to the Lord. And just like Hannah, we can pray with a quiet heart afterwards, knowing that in His still and quiet presence, we find solace that calms our troubled hearts. Charles Spurgeon, a well-known preacher, had this quote that portrayed Hannah's faith so beautifully. To trust God in the light is nothing, but trust Him in the dark, that is faith. In trying times, let's continue to gaze our eyes on the Lord. And so we see Hannah's faith in God when she made a promise, a vow to God that if she gives her a son, she will let him serve the Lord all his life. In 1 Samuel chapter 1 verse 11, it says, "And she made a vow saying, Lord Almighty, if you will only look on your servant's misery and remember me, and not forget your servant but give her a son, then I will give him to the Lord for all the days of his life, and no razor will ever be used on his head." Hannah offered something to God, or do something for God in return for an answered prayer. Now during Old Testament times, when a person makes a vow, it showed great desire of the person when asking a favor from God. Any person who made a vow is bound and obligated to fulfill it. Note that a vow is sacred, and the person who made it must fulfill what was promised, or he or she will be accountable by God. In short, Hannah made a pact with the Lord and she intends to fulfill it when God grants her request to have a son. Hannah's total confidence in the Lord was very evident in her actions. Despite Hannah's pain and anguish, she still acknowledged that God is in control. She showed humility and submission to God, as if saying, "Be mindful of my situation, Lord. Please don't forget me." It is evident that Hannah's great desire is to have a child and be a mother is her top priority. Everything else is secondary. Whether the child stays with her or not is not her primary concern. It is as if she's telling God, "Just give me a son so I can be a mother and I will give him back to you, Lord. Gawin mo lang akong nanay, just allow me to have a son. Ma-experience ko lang maging ina kahit mawalay pa siya sa akin to serve in your house. Lord, okay lang." And all this time, Eli was there, the high priest, watching her. So when Eli confronted her, thinking she's drunk, Hannah told her story. And when Eli heard about it, he blessed Hannah and asked God to grant her request. And we read in verse 18, Hannah said, "Oh, thank you, sir," she exclaimed. Then she went back and began to eat again, and she was no longer sad. What we saw was there was a change in Hannah's demeanor after Eli asked God to grant her request to have a son. Deep in Hannah's heart, she knew that God would grant her request and that gave her assurance and comfort. And as we continue in the third milestone of Hannah's story, God's purpose and timing, from verse 19 to 20, it tells us that when Hannah and her family went back home to their hometown, God actually remembered Hannah's pleading and gave her a son. And Hannah named her son Samuel. The Lord is now starting to align the timings according to His plan and design. Now, in many situations of our life, God may not reveal His purpose and plan to us. So we struggle to understand His purpose because we can't fully see His plans. And we wonder, what's God gonna do with my situation? Is He going to help me? When, Lord? How long, Lord? We actually become desperate and almost feel like giving up. But we can be assured that God definitely had a plan. He had the vantage point. In every situation, His timing is perfect. As a loving father, be assured that God is doing something in us. That as His children, we can take comfort that He will always be there to guide and protect us. Because God's loving kindness gives delight to a broken heart. The closing of Hannah's womb was in fact God's design. to prepare for the birth of an important figure. Samuel had an important role to fulfill for God's people, Israel, and he needed to be born at the right timing of God, just in time. Hannah in the temple crying her heart out to God, making her vow to God, meeting Eli, and Eli blessing her. All these needed to happen first to accomplish God's design and purpose. God's purposes were far greater than only granting Hannah her desire to have a son. God's plan required Samuel at the right place at the right time to prepare him for greater tasks. As a prophet, as the greatest judge Israel had, and as the anointer of the first and second king of Israel, King Saul and King David. And from David's lineage will Jesus be born. Now we see the connected dots, and we are now able to understand God's purpose for Hannah. Many times, only when we look back in retrospect at what happened, can we realize that all the time, God was actually orchestrating things to be in the rightful place at the right time. We just have to wait and trust Him fully. And so we arrive now in the finale of Hannah's story timeline. Hannah's response to God. From the account in verses 22 to 23, Hannah took care of Samuel until he is weaned, which means he can now be separated from her mother since he can take other food and not depend on mother's milk anymore. As we read in verse 24 to 25, when the child was weaned, Hannah took him to the tabernacle in Shiloh. They brought along a 3-year-old bull for the sacrifice, and a basket of flour and some wine. After sacrificing the bull, they brought the boy to Eli. Now Samuel at this time was about 3 to 5 years old when Hannah returned with him to Shiloh, ready to part him away to Eli to serve in the house of the Lord. And in verses 26 to 28, it says, "Sir, do you remember me?" Hannah asked. "I am the very woman who stood here several years ago praying to the Lord. I asked the Lord to give me this boy, and he has granted my request. Now I am giving him to the Lord, and he will belong to the Lord his whole life." And they worshiped the Lord there. We saw how Hannah approached Eli and reintroduced herself as that woman she thought was drunk, and told him about how God answered her prayers, and now she is ready to fulfill her end of that vow she made to the Lord, to give back his son, to serve in the Lord's temple. One notable thing in that particular scene was the way she approached and talked with Eli. Hannah seemed to be okay and not having a hard time to let go and be separated from her son Samuel. What we can sense in here was excitement, happiness, and contentment. There's no sign of regret on her part. One probable reason would be because she knows that her son would be in the house of the Lord serving, and the rest is about her full confidence and gratitude for what God has given her to experience motherhood and have a son. Hannah had the assurance that Samuel was in good hands, that he will be taken care of. For Hannah, the time she had taking care of Samuel was enough. God had gifted her with a son, and now he will be trained to serve in the house of the Lord. And for her, that's already a privilege. Perhaps there's a tinge of sadness and separation anxiety, as all moms would have, knowing how hard it would have been for a mother to part with her child who haven't even reached their teenage years. But Hannah knew in her heart she had full confidence in God's purpose for her and Samuel's calling. And as we read in the succeeding chapter, because of Hannah's obedience and full trust in the Lord, she was blessed with 5 more children. She not only had a son who will serve the Lord, but God gave her more than she asked for. Just like Hannah, we all have our share of bad experiences. If you look at who or what caused that hurt, it's always people who trigger them. Our family, friends, classmates, neighbors, office mates, our bosses, our teachers, and many others. People will often fail and hurt us. And Hannah showed us how we can overcome that hurt. And that's by drawing near to our Lord, to cry out to Him for help, for rescue, that in our weakness, let God be glorified as He manifests and unfolds His love in our lives. because God's loving kindness gives delight to a broken heart. Hannah's hurt led her to the Lord. And just like Hannah, we too must let our hurts draw us near to the Lord, because His steadfast love, His loving kindness, His chesed will never cease. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted, and He rescues those whose spirits are crushed. When we feel that God is distant and far away, when it seems so hard to understand what God is doing, and we cry out loud and ask Him, "How long, Lord, how long?" Anchor our faith and hope in the Lord. Trust Him that He hears our prayers and that He's at work, that He is doing something. Let's trust in His timing. It may seem our waiting is taking too long and we are getting frustrated and tired. But remember, God has the vantage point. He knows what we don't. Trust in His word, on His promises, because He always keeps His promise. It is in those times when we are brokenhearted that we actually experience God. Hannah did. God hears our cries and He feels our pain. He knows our longings and He sees our daily struggles, and He longs to heal our brokenness. And just like Hannah, we just have to come to the Lord with all our being, just as we are, so He can wrap His loving arms around us, whispering to our ears, "I got you now, my child. You're safe." It is also during our trying times that we experience our necessary growth. We come out of the experience more mature, with a firmer and deeper faith in God, so our characters gets molded. Our heart becomes more joyful, and our eyes fix only to the source of our strength and hope, our Lord Jesus Christ, who loves us so much. I love how Spurgeon beautifully described hope. Hope itself is like a star not to be seen in the sunshine of prosperity and only to be discovered in the night of adversity. Our God is always there. He actually never left our side when we are down and troubled. God turns our mourning into dancing because God's loving kindness gives delight to a broken heart. And this is the challenge for all of us today. Trust His heart. God's heart is full of love towards us, that He even gave His Son Jesus for us to be reconciled with Him. In times we don't understand and we doubt whether God is at work or care for what's happening in our lives, trust His heart. Pray about it, because God will never fail us. As a child trusts a loving father, we can trust our Heavenly Father that will always be there to make a way for us. I love how Pastor Craig Rochelle puts it. If it's big enough to worry about, it's big enough to pray about it. Anxieties, worries are actually signals alerting us that it's time to pray. Let's lift it up to God. And that's exactly what Hannah did. And so should we, because God's loving kindness gives delight to a broken heart. I'd like all of us to listen to this wonderful song that reminds us how great and magnificent our God is. It's comforting to know that in our troubles and pain, we have a big and loving God who truly cares and loves us.
To the one whose dreams are falling all apart, and all you're left with is a tired and broken heart, I can tell by your eyes you think you're on your own, but you're not alone.
Have you heard of the one who can calm the raging sea? Give sight to the blind, pull the lame up to their feet. With a love so strong, He'll never let you go. No, you're not alone.
You will be safe in His arms. You will be safe in His arms. As the hands that hold the world are holding your heart.
This is the promise He He will be with you always, when everything is falling apart. safe in His arms.
Did you know that the voice that brings the dead to life is the very same voice that calls you now to rise? So hear Him now, He's calling you home. You will never be alone. You will be safe in His arms. You will be safe in His arms. 'Cause the hands that hold the world are holding your heart. This is the promise He made. He will be with you always. When everything is falling apart, you will be safe in His arms.
These are the hands that fill the mountains. These are the hands that calm the seas.
These are the arms that hold the heavens. They are holding you and me. These are the hands that heal the leper, pull the lame up to their feet. These are the arms that nail to a cross, to break our chains and set us free. You will be safe in His arms. You will be safe in His arms. The hands that hold the world are holding your heart. This is the promise He made.
Thank you for that beautiful response song that speaks clearly of how we can be safe in the Father's arms, especially when we need it the most. And as we close, allow me to pray for all of us as we bow down our heads and pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, we come into your fold and into your throne of grace today. And we just lay down at your feet all our cares, all our worries, our hurts, and everything that troubles our hearts today. The uncertainties of our situation, our jobs, our bills to pay, safety of our loved ones, all these are things that worries and wear us down. The cry of our hearts when we seem to be in the dark for so long is, how long, O God? How long will our misery end? We are tired, Lord, but then we remember your goodness and your promises that you would never leave us nor forsake us. That in our wandering, in our finite understanding and viewpoint, we just put our trust and hope in you, our Almighty God. You haven't always been in control of everything, and you hold us in your hands, and you will never fail us. You remain faithful. And so with that assurance, we continue to trust your heart and put our hope into you, our Almighty Father. To you be the glory, the honor, and the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless us all, and see you next Sunday.